Enjoying meeting fans in London today?
It's been great, man. London is the best. I love it. Having a great time here.
So you've been involved in a lot of great shows, a lot of great films. I'm sure that amongst those, The Walking Dead is still something that you get a lot of fans coming up to you to chat about. Why do you think the show is the phenomenon that it still remains to this day?
The show is still a phenomenon because it's still telling story. The story is still about the people. You know what I mean? It's not about the walkers, it's about the people. And when you're telling real stories about, you know, the human experience and what it would be like in that situation, circumstance, you know, it's going to appeal to people. People are going to become attached to the characters, relate to the characters and what they're going through. Like Bob, you know, people could relate to that guy. There would be somebody who's struggling with what he was struggling with if that happened, you know? So I think that's very appealing even still. And that's why it's still a phenomenon today. Well, I mean, just, you know, for me, the whole alcoholism, you know, how he was dealing with that, because a lot of people have a lot of different addictions, you know, and what Bob had to learn through Sasha helped him to realize and to understand that, you know, it's about loving yourself. You have to learn how to love yourself, and then you can, you know, beat any addiction, whatever it is, you know what I mean? So just going through that whole thing and actually bringing that to light for people, because whenever I'm playing a character, a particular character, I know that there's someone out in the world, like that's a real person somewhere, you know what I mean? So I try to do that justice, some kind of justice. So it was important to me to be real with it, and I just enjoyed bringing that character to life, you know?
I think one of the reasons that The Wire is, for many people, a high watermark for television production was the level of just reality that series managed to craft. Can you talk a little bit about being part of what remains such a very important, I think for many people, watershed moment for television programming?
Well, I mean, that was kind of just like The Wire was one of those shows where just like all the stars aligned and the heavens opened, and you know, it was just an amazing show to be on for me personally, having spent 10 years living in Baltimore and growing up there. It was just magical, man, being on that show. That was another show that was very important to me for different reasons, but also that character was definitely someone who was real, you know what I mean? I knew guys like that and when I lived in Baltimore, you know, who were that guy, D'Angelo. So that show's never going to die. It's always going to have a special place in my heart, you know what I mean? Yeah. It was just a great show to be on, and just a blessing to be on that show. There's no one special moment that I can recall on that show. I mean, there were some amazing moments, like the Where's Wallace scene. That was pretty special. The chess scene was amazing. You know what I mean? There were some pretty, pretty great moments. No one really stands out. And I think when you're dealing with great writers like, you know, David Simon and George Pelicanos, and Ed Burns, when you're dealing with great writers, everything they write is going to be brilliant. So you're always going to get those special moments every episode. You know what I mean? So The Deuce is another great show. The same team that did The Wire, you know, David Simon, George Pelicanos, Nina Noble, HBO. So I'm happy to be back with the HBO family. And you know, that's another show. I mean, all David Simon shows, you know, have that social element to it, pointing fingers at, you know, just certain social situations that are going on, pointing the finger at issues that people need to focus in on. I think anyway, right now the whole Me Too movement is working on. So it's interesting that he's doing a show that's about prostitution and the porn industry. You know, but just the way he's projecting it, the women in the show actually have all the power. You know what I mean? If you watch the show. So it's great to be on that show. It's great to be working with quality producers, quality writers on a quality network. That's always great. So I'm having a ball doing that. Well, that show jumps around quite a bit. So, you know, season one to season two, it jumped like 5 or 6 years, and then it's going to do the same. So when we come back to season three, it's going to be 1985. You know, things have changed quite a bit in New York City, and things are changing pretty rapidly in Times Square, the Deuce, you know, in particular. But you can expect the same tone. It's going to be gritty. It's going to be, you know, it's going to take its time and tell the stories, you know. And that's what's so exciting and interesting about a David Simon show is that he takes the time to introduce the characters and to develop the characters in full, you know. And it takes time to do that. So, but that's what's exciting and that's what's interesting for me anyway, is watching the human condition as it lives through, as it goes through life, you know what I mean? As we live through life, watching our condition, what we do with the situations that we're placed in, you know, and how we overcome adversities. And so it's going to just be more of that, bro.
From the sublime to the ridiculous, The Waterboy is a cult favorite for many fans. Can you talk a little bit about being involved in that particular slice of Adam Sandler comedy genius?
Yo, dude, that's still the most fun that I've had on a movie. I don't even know how we got that movie made, because all we did was show up and laugh and joke all day long, like, as we were shooting it. And Adam is just a comic genius, you know? He would do things like, say, let's say I'm writing something with my right hand in the scene. He'd say, write it with your left hand, it'll be funnier. And I'd go, what do you mean? He'd go, just try it. And I'd do it, and it'd be funnier. He just knows funny, man. Everyone on that show, on that film, was amazing. It was just an amazing, amazing experience. And that also still holds a special place in my heart, that film.
Does the Bobby Boucher voice, I mean, was he keeping that going in between takes? Was it always, you know, my mama says we got to do another take now?
No. So Adam, you know, he's one of those cats who turns it on and off. He's actually a really shy guy, you know, but then when they go action, he just turns it on and he's just there, man. You know what I mean? Very smart guy. So he's usually, like I said, he's shy, but he's also really quiet. So he's usually in the back just studying and watching, blah, 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 blah. And then, and just so super smart about it. And then when they go action, he would just turn on the switch and just go. And then you're trying to stay in the scene with him and not just burst into laughter, you know? It was super hard, super hard. I mean, whenever he would break into his Bobby Boucher, you know, the voice even, you're standing there and you're just trying to keep a straight face, you know what I mean? But there was no one particular one that, there were many where I just had to contain myself and just like, how are these guys not cracking up right now because I'm about to pee my pants? A message from my fans. I love my fans and I hope you guys are still loving me. Ha ha ha!